Good morning. So in this session, we will try to see some MCQs, okay, which will help us to understand whatever we have studied in module 4 and 5 in the course on power system analysis. So this is Professor Uma Rao from RV College of Engineering, bringing you the lectures under the eSikshana program of VTU. Okay, so let us see the questions and what how we can analyze them. So we saw in the regular sessions how to solve problems, how to apply Runge-Kutta method, Euler method, step-by-step method, and how to solve for hydrothermal scheduling and so on. But when you answer MCQs, even for your competitive exams, it is necessary for you to recollect the fundamentals. Okay, so it is very easy to come to a wrong conclusion whenever you're answering MCQs. And as you know, almost all your gate questions are based on MCQs. You have to choose the correct answer. You don't have any descriptive kind of questions. And even when you take up other competitive exams like UPSC, etc., IES, you have to face such questions. So I will discuss the questions and I will also tell you why that particular answer is correct. Now, so let us start. Generator speed variation will actuate. So while we answer, we'll also summarize whatever we have learned in the course. So whenever the generator speed changes, what happens? The frequency also will change. Now we know that to maintain the speed at the nominal value or the reference value, we need to balance the active power, right? So, and the active power is controlled by the turbine input in conventional generators. And the turbine, that is the input from the turbine, which is the turbine output, right? So is controlled by the governors of the turbine. Clear? So if you just look at your, recollect your generation, what do we have? We have the turbine, which acts as the prime mover, and input to the turbine in conventional plant is either steam or water, controlled by suitable governors. And then the output of the turbine is the input to the generator, right? And the frequency of the generated voltage depends on the balance between the generator input and the generator output, that is the electrical power drawn from the generator. Clear? So now any change in the load, any change in the load will change the speed of the generator, because the changes will be buffered by the kinetic energy of the generator rotor, and this will be reflected in the frequency. So by monitoring the frequency, we come to know whether there is an active power imbalance. So if the frequency is more than the nominal frequency, it means that the demand is less than the generation. So the frequency has gone up because the excess input energy goes into the kinetic energy of the generator and its speed will go up, and hence the frequency will increase. So whenever the frequency increases, we have to reduce the turbine output. Always remember that. Whenever the frequency in the system increases, we have to reduce the turbine output. Similarly, when the load increases, the frequency will fall. So a drop in the frequency implies that the generation is less than the demand. So to meet for the excess demand, the kinetic energy will be converted into electrical energy and the speed of the generator will come down. So in such a case, the turbine output has to be increased. We have to increase the generation. Clear? So this is the entire concept which we study in stability and also in your load frequency control. Therefore, any generator speed variation will actuate the prime mover governors. The prime mover governors. Okay, so that is the correct answer. Next. So it will not affect the voltage regulation. Voltage regulation will be done by the automatic voltage regulators based on the terminal voltage. Load compensators are for power factor correction or for balancing an unbalanced system. So the correct answer is prime mover governors. Okay. Next, voltage and frequency variations will affect what? It will affect the system load. Because your loads are rated for a particular voltage and a particular frequency, and some of the loads may be very delicate, right? And if you take typically loads like electronic loads, they are very susceptible to voltage variations, and they may even malfunction. Even a lot of your protective equipment, they also get affected with voltage and frequency variations. So the voltage and frequency variations will affect the system load, and different types of load react differently to voltage and frequency. So actually, whenever you have a load, you can characterize the load by its active power and reactive power. What is the active power drawn by the load and what is the reactive power drawn by the load? So these two will help you to characterize the load, right? So we normally have four parameters defined for different types of loads. What are the parameters? Dou P by dou V. That means how does the active power drawn by the load depend on the voltage? So the differential relationship, dou P by dou V. Then we have dou P by dou F. How does the active power change with the frequency? Similarly, you have dou Q by dou V and dou Q by dou F. So these parameters are specific to the type of load. So normally, dou P by dou F will be high and dou Q by dou V will be high. In most of the cases. So the reactive power drawn by the load will be more dependent on the voltage magnitude, and the active power will be dependent on the frequency. However, you can't jump to this conclusion. It will depend on the type of load. So AC machines, air conditioners, washing machines, industrial loads, pumps, motors, lighting and in lighting, fluorescent, incandescent, then arc furnaces. So each of them have a different characteristic parameters. Okay. And similarly, these values can also be defined for seasons, because the type of loads we use in different seasons are different. In the winter, you might predominantly be using heaters, which are mostly resistive. And in summers, we may be using air conditioners, which have a lower power factor. So these values of lumped aggregated loads, these values of dou P by dou V, dou P by dou F, etc., this will also depend on the season. Clear? Therefore, we can conclude that voltage and frequency variations will affect the system loads, the loads in the system. The buses are solid, and they are not very widely affected by voltage variations, because you would have designed it for a particular voltage level. So you have 11 kV bus, a 33 kV bus, a 220 kV bus. Okay. So even if instead of 220 kV, if it is 200 kV or 240 kV, the bus will not get affected. Okay. Similarly, the transmission lines also. And the system operators, from a control point of view, yes, but they will not get affected. Right. So the correct answer is system load. So whenever you answer such MCQs, give a thought. Why an option can be wrong before you just blindly tick an option. Now, if a power system withstands the variation of load, and performs satisfactorily, that means doesn't trip too many things, then the system is said to be steady state stable. Stable, I'm sure you can answer, but what type of stability is it? Is it steady state stable, transient state stable, load stability, or all of them? So now just look at the statement. The power system is able to withstand the variations of the load. What are the load variations? And perform satisfactorily. So what this means is that as the load changes, the system is able to keep up its stable condition. It can withstand, means it can keep up its stable condition. So here there is no fault, right? And there is no abrupt large change in the load. Like it's not as if a huge industrial load is rejected. It's not a large change in a load. It is simply the normal variations of the load, which is present because of the dynamic nature of the power system. So if your system cannot withstand this, please remember you cannot operate the system itself. If a small amount of load is thrown off and the system goes into a blackout, or a huge part of the network grid is disconnected and generators and loads trip, right? Then it's not an acceptable operating point. Clear? So when we design the system, we should design it with enough margins, security, with enough of security, so that all the normal load variations that occur naturally in the system can be withstood by the system. So this refers to steady state stability. That means when the system is in steady state, whatever changes occur, the system can withstand it. The system can withstand it. It can bring back the voltage and frequency to normal operating conditions by using whatever control we have. Okay, that is the correct option. So transient state stability is when you have a large disturbance. So we are not talking of that condition here. Load stability is rapid and large changes in the load. So the correct answer for this question is steady state stability. Now, dash depends on the type of disturbance, the location, and magnitude of disturbance. So in the previous question, I told you the steady state stability is simply the ability to withstand the normal load variations of the system. The ability to withstand normal load variations of the system, that is steady state stability. Now, transient stability is the ability to withstand large variations, large faults. Okay, there is a drastic change in the network. A line is opened, a generator trips, or there is a three-phase short circuit. So this will depend on the type of disturbance. How the system behaves to a three-phase short circuit will be entirely different. Because when you have a three-phase short circuit at any point in the system, what happens? The voltage at that point will come down to zero. Clear? So it will, the response of the system to that will be very different from the response to, say, a 20% increase in the load, or a 10% decrease in the load, or a single line to ground fault. Okay, so the type of disturbance is very important. The system may be stable for one type of fault, but may become unstable for another type of fault. And location. So just think you have a generator, right? And then a step-up transformer, and then a radial line and the load. Okay, so the worst fault you can have is there is a short circuit right at the generator terminals. It will lead to a huge current. You may have a short circuit on the high voltage side of the transformer. So that time what happens? The transformer impedance also will limit the fault current. So now the current is different. The fault current is different. You may have a short circuit somewhere in the middle of the line. In this case, the short circuit current is different. Okay, so the location is also important. And obviously the magnitude. The same example I gave you can show you how the location will affect the magnitude of the fault current. So the limit which depends on all this is the transient stability limit, because it's a large fault. So steady state, as we have seen, is for small naturally occurring disturbances in the system loads. Okay, so the correct option is transient stability limit. So you cannot make a statement saying this system has a fault clearing time, critical fault clearing time of 10 seconds or 20 seconds. You can't make that statement, because you have to specify for what kind of fault, for which fault. Are you clear? So the transient stability limit depends extensively on the location, on the type of disturbances, and what type of protection you have, etc. So the correct option here is transient stability limit. Next. Steady state stability is basically concerned with the determination of upper limit of machine loading before losing synchronism, lower limit of machine's loading before losing synchronism, kinds of loads connected to the power system, and types of faults that occur in the system. So what is steady state limit? We saw that. What is steady state stability? So I have the system operating in stable state, and whatever normal variations are there, it should be able to maintain the stability. So what is the maximum power I can transfer under steady state for this condition to be met? That is the steady state limit. Clear? So if just let us say I'm operating at some particular level, P1. P is the active power. Okay. Now, at this power level, if there are any fluctuations in the load, my system may oscillate and it will come back to its original position. Now I increase it. So now some more. Now at this, I increase it to some limit. And at this point, what happens? If there is any increase in the load, the system will become unstable. The system will become unstable. Clear? So therefore, the steady state stability basically is concerned with what is the upper limit of the machine's loading. So this upper limit will determine a naturally occurring steady state stability. So it determines the upper limit of the machine's loading before losing synchronism. Clear? So it's not the lower limit, it's the upper limit. Next. Transient stability limit is almost always dashed steady state limit, lower than, higher than, equal to, or approximately equal. Now, we discussed what is steady state. Steady state is the ability, steady state stability is the ability to be stable for small variations in load. Whereas transient stability is the ability to be stable for large differences in the operating conditions. So a system has to be steady state stable. Otherwise, you can't operate the system. So if it is steady state stable, doesn't mean that it will be transiently stable. That means it is steady state stability is stability for small disturbances. That doesn't mean that it will be stable for large disturbances. Okay. Therefore, transient stability limit is almost always lower than steady state limit, because I have to give a margin. I have to give a margin for the system to maintain stability for large disturbances. I don't have the same margin as I have for steady state stability limit. So it will always be lower than the steady state stability limit. And this limit will also depend on what is the kind of fault I am talking, on the location of the fault. So you can ask me, if it depends on the location of the fault and the type of fault, how do I determine the transient stability limit? So take the worst case, the worst scenario. Okay, so that you can call it as the limit, because for any other fault and any other location, it will be better. So most often we take the three-phase short circuit as the worst fault. The most severe fault that can occur is the three-phase short circuit. We consider that and we see at which location it gives the worst fault current, and that we can call it as the transient stability limit. Next, dash depends on ability of each synchronous machine to maintain equilibrium between electrical and mechanical torque. Now, I just explained to you the concept of steady state stability. So there we are matching the active power demand and generation. So if this balance is upset, if this balance is upset, then the frequency will either go up or come down. So this is called as the rotor angle stability, because the frequency directly depends on the speed, and that depends on the internal angle, the torque angle of the synchronous machine, that is the alternator, right? So here, when we talk of the synchronous machine, we are basically talking of the alternator connected to the turbine. So it depends on the ability of each synchronous machine, the rotor angle stability. That depends on the ability of each synchronous machine to maintain equilibrium between electrical and mechanical torque. Okay. For small signals, rotor angle stability depends on operating point, type of disturbance, nature of fault, and all of the options, all of them. So again, rotor angle stability has to do with frequency, active power, and small signal means steady state for small disturbances. So as I told you, that will depend on the operating point. Operating point. Clear? So the correct answer is operating point. So if your system is small signal unstable, you can't operate it. What is the meaning of small signal instability? It means that even for a small disturbance which occurs naturally in the system will become unstable. It can't even take the natural load variations that occur in the power system. That's the meaning of small signal stability. So it is purely dependent on the operating point. If your operating point itself is unstable, you cannot even operate the system. So how do I check the operating point stability? How do I check the operating point stability? So what you have to do is, you have a system of nonlinear equations. You linearize it around the operating point and then find out the poles and zeros of the transfer function. If all the poles lie on the left-hand side of the S-plane, then the system is small signal stability. This you have studied in control theory. So for stability, all the poles must have negative real parts. That means they have to lie on the left-hand side of the S-plane. So that determines only operating point stability. You can call it as small signal stability or steady state stability, all mean the same. So you cannot use that law for assessment of transient stability. So the only way you can assess transient stability is for simple systems, you can go for equal area criteria, or for larger systems, you have to do a simulation, observe the swing curve and see whether the angle is continuously increasing or decreasing. There's no other way you can assess the transient stability. Clear? So the correct option here is operating point. Next, long-term voltage instability is due to. So voltage instability means the voltage goes on changing and may ultimately collapse. That means the voltage may fall very low, below the operating acceptable operating point. So long-term voltage instability is due to loss of long-term equilibrium. So ultimately, voltage stability and angle stability will be interlinked. A persistent occurrence of one will definitely lead to the other. Will definitely lead to the other. So the correct answer is loss of long-term equilibrium. Next, frequency instability will lead to tripping of generator units or loads. Nothing will happen to the system. A complete shutdown, protective equipment to respond immediately. So frequency instability means the frequency is continuously increasing or decreasing. There's a trend, goes up or comes down. Okay, so this will lead to a natural tripping of the generating units and loads. Now, every generator is equipped with an under-frequency relay and an over-frequency relay. So these have some thresholds. The thresholds are determined by the grid code of the country, the grid code of the country, whichever country we are referring to. So if the threshold is crossed, then the relay will trip the generating unit. Similarly, motors, large loads, they are also equipped with under frequency and over frequency relays. The reason is with generators, you are operating generators in synchronism. In the grid, all the generators are synchronized. So they all have to run at the same frequency. They all have to run at the same frequency. Clear? So therefore, if the frequency of one generator deviates, then it cannot remain in synchronism. So it will fall out of step and it will get tripped. Now with loads, the loads are designed for a particular frequency. So if the frequency is higher or lower, then it can malfunction the load, or the load can even get damaged. And for this reason, the loads are also tripped, right? So the frequency instability will lead to tripping of generator units or loads. Today, especially in almost all the countries and in India, we have a very fine mechanism to maintain the frequency. Clear? So there are huge penalties on the distribution companies if they do not operate the system at the correct frequency, close to the nominal frequency, within the band prescribed by the code, within the band prescribed by the code. Next, angular momentum depends on the size of the machine. The angular momentum will depend basically on the size of the machine. Swing curve is a plot between, we already know, between rotor angle and time. That's the meaning of the swing curve. So why the name swing curve? How the generator swings, how the generator angle swings. So that's why it's called as a swing curve. Next, at steady state, shaft torque is equal to electromagnetic torque. So you think of the generator, the shaft torque is the mechanical torque, and then you have the electromagnetic torque, that is the T. So when these two are balanced, the system will be in steady state. Okay. And for a and it will be running at nominal speed, whatever is the normal speed. And if you excite the field winding of the generator, it will generate voltage at nominal frequency. Clear? So when I talk of nominal speed, I mean the synchronous speed, because we are talking of synchronous machines in this case. Now, if the shaft torque is more, then the generator will accelerate, because there is more mechanical input than you have the electrical output. So input is more means the generator will accelerate. Now, if the shaft torque is less than the electromagnetic torque, the generator will decelerate. The frequency will fall. Clear? So when the two are equal, then the system will be operating at nominal frequency, Therefore, under all conditions, the steady state shaft torque should be equal to the electromagnetic torque. Next, if the rotor angle reaches a maximum and then decreases, it shows that the system has transient stability, unstable operation, loses complete synchronism, and the machine is good. Let us see what's happening. So this is a swing curve, Rotor angle versus time is nothing but the swing curve. In the swing curve, I observe that the angle increases and then it comes down. So in the first swing, this is called as the first swing. As soon as a fault occurs or a change in the system occurs, so even the change in the system, like a sudden rejection of a load, a sudden application of a load, all these are also called, considered as faults. So the generator angle will increase and then it decreases. So this is called as the first swing, right? And this, if this is observed, then today with modern controls we have in place, we make a statement that if the system has first swing stability, then it is stable. So when manual controls were there, this statement could not be made because a generator angle could go up, come down, and then again shoot up, and it could become unstable. But with modern controls, this doesn't happen. So we always, whenever we do a simulation, we look for what is called as first swing stability. That means after a fault occurs, observe the rotor angle, and if it increases and comes down, then you can say the system is stable, and this refers to transient stability. Clear? So I need to observe this only for transient stability. We don't need it for steady state stability. Steady state stability, as I told you, I can assess it without solving for the swing equation by just looking at the poles and zeros of the network. Next. It is not unstable because when the angle increases and comes down, it denotes a stable system, and it will not lose synchronism because it has come down. So the correct answer is it indicates transient stability. Next, the maximum time available for clearing the fault before the system loses stability. What does that statement mean? I have a system, a fault occurs, right? Every fault does not lead to instability. Now I clear the fault after some time, and the system, what happens, just what I discussed in the previous question, the angle increases and then it comes down after the fault is cleared. So the system becomes stable. Now I clear it after a longer time. So again, the angle goes up now to a slightly higher limit and then comes down. Next, I clear it for a still longer time. Now I clear the fault, but the angle doesn't come, it goes up. That means it has gained enough of kinetic energy and it's not able to dissipate it after the fault is cleared, right? So the maximum time available for you for clearing the fault before which the system loses stability. That means you should clear the fault before this time. Otherwise, the system will become unstable. That is called as the critical clearing time. The fault clearing time could be anything. You can clear the fault after 1 minute, 2 minutes, 5 seconds, after 10 minutes, anything. So that is the fault clearing time. So the correct answer here is critical clearing time. So this critical clearing time gives you an indication of how much time is available for you before the system becomes unstable. Okay. The principle by which stability under transient conditions is determined without solving the swing equation, but makes use of areas in the power angle diagram. This is nothing but your equal area criteria. So what do we do in equal area criteria? We can only apply it for single machine infinite bus or two machine, which can be reduced to an SMIB system. So if you have a larger machine, can I make use of equal area criteria? Yes. So when you have a larger system, when you have a larger system with many machines, what we do is first, then what happens? A group of machines will swing in one direction. Another group of machines will swing in another direction. So these are called as coherent machines. So a group of coherent machines can be reduced to one single equivalent machine. So generally in a larger system with many machines, I can reduce it to a two machine equivalent, which can again be reduced to a single machine infinite bus equivalent, and then we can apply equal area criteria. So in equal area criteria, what we do is, whatever is the accelerating area, that means the acceleration which the machine picks up, after the fault is cleared, it must decelerate. It must give up the energy, excess of energy which it has acquired, right? So that is assessed by the equal area criteria without doing a simulation. So dash is an error sensing device in load frequency control. It is your governor. So we saw the governor controls the active power balance. And so that is you can call that as the error sensing device. The AVR, automatic voltage regulator loop, is faster than the automatic load frequency control loop. It acts very fast compared to the ALFC control. A governor which brings back the frequency to its nominal value is called, see what happens is, normally these governors are given a small droop. That means the speed between no load to full load will drop by a small amount, around 3% or so. It will have a negative slope. So this is done for proper load sharing between the alternators connected in parallel. This is called as the droop characteristic. Now there is one machine, which is your reference bus, slack bus, etc., where the turbine has what is called as an isochronous governor. That means it will have a flat characteristic. The speed will be a constant from no load to full load. So this will help to maintain the frequency, because if the speed is a constant, right, frequency will be a constant. That's why in your load flow also you see, you know, any deficit in the load is transferred to the slack bus, because the slack bus is the largest generator, right? And you don't put any load on it initially. You keep it as a buffer. So if the load on the system varies, that is buffered by the slack bus. And the governor of the slack bus will be operating in isochronous mode. That means it will have a flat output versus speed curve. Stiffness of the system indicates the change in the frequency which would occur for a change in the load. Right? When you say a stiff system, means the frequency remains more or less a constant. A weak system is where the stiffness is not there. The frequency will vary. So stiffness of the system is indicative of the change in the frequency which would occur for a particular change in the load. So what is the percentage change in the load which will cause a 1% change in frequency? So if your frequency is 50 Hertz, what change in load will cause a frequency change of 0.5 Hertz? That's defined as the damping constant. Okay. So for every 1% change in the, if you say the damping constant is 5%, that means for a 5% change in the load, the frequency will change by 1%, increase or decrease. Right? If the load decreases, the frequency will increase. If the load increases, the frequency will decrease. So damping constant is defined as the percentage change in load for 1% change in frequency, whatever is required. Now let's see some simple numericals. I have two power stations, A and B, located close together. A has four identical generators, each rated at 100 MVA, 9 megajoules per MVA, that is your H, inertia constant H. Station B has three sets rated at 200 MVA and 4 megajoules per MVA. Calculate the inertia constant of the equivalent machines of both stations on 150 MVA base. Right? So how would you do it? See here, let us take station A, right? They're both connected in parallel. So station A has four identical generators. It is 9 megajoules per MVA. So the total inertia constant of these four will be 9 into 4. That is 36 megajoules per MVA. But this 36 megajoules per MVA is on a base of 100 MVA. On a base of 100 MVA. Now, I want to convert it to a base of 150 MVA. So this 150 MVA, we call it as a system base. What is the base I want to choose for the entire system? And this 100 MVA is called as the machine base. So your formula to convert the inertia constant from one base to another base is the inertia constant in the system base is equal to inertia constant into machine base multiplied by the rating on the machine, the power rating of the machine divided by the base rating of the system. So here the machine power rating is 100 and the system power rating is 150. So it will be 9 into 436 into 100 by 150. This is for station A. It is paralleled with station B. So station B has three sets, each with 4 megajoules. So 3 into 4. And the machine MVA is 200 and the system MVA is 150. So I get 3 into 4, 12 into 200 by 150. That is equal to 40 megajoules per MVA. Clear? 40 megajoules per MVA. Next. A 2-pole 50 hertz turbo alternator has a rating of 85 megawatts with a power factor of 0.85 lagging. The rotor inertia constant, that is H, whether it, you know, some authors they call M also, the angular momentum also has inertia constant. I've seen it. So from the units, you can make out whether it is H or M. So the unit of H is megajoules per MVA. So this is H. Calculate M. Simple. The formula for M. So the unit is megajoules second per degree electrical. It is megajoules second per degree electrical. It can also be megajoule second per degree radian, radian electrical. That is the electrical angle is referred to in radians. These are the two commonly used units for M. So the formula to calculate M is GH by 180F. G is the MVA rating. H is the inertia constant divided by 180 into frequency. So here I have G is MVA. So it is 85 megawatts, 0.85 lag. So the MVA will be the megawatt by power factor because power factor is equal to MVA into, the MVA is equal to megawatt by power factor or megawatt is equal to MVA into power factor. VI cos phi, right? VI is MVA cos phi and megawatt. So the MVA for this will be 85 divided by 0.85, which is 100. So G into H, H is 5 divided by 180 into 50, 180 into frequency, it's 50 hertz. So that is 0.055 megajoule second per degree electrical. So the correct answer is the first option. Next. Inertia constant for a 60 hertz 100 MVA hydroelectric generator is 4 megajoules MVA per MVA. If the input to the generator suddenly increases by 20 MVA, what is the acceleration imparted? Okay, now what is the formula for acceleration? Md squared delta by dt squared, your swing equation, remember. Md squared delta by dt squared is equal to Pa, the accelerating power. D squared delta by dt squared is the acceleration, right? So the acceleration is Pa by M. Pa is the accelerating power. And what is the accelerating power? The difference between the mechanical power and the electrical power, or the difference between the input and output to the generator. If the input is more than the output, the generator will accelerate. If the input is less than the output, the generator will decelerate or it will have negative acceleration. So first I have to calculate M. M is equal to, it is anyway 100 MVA, G into H, H is 4 by 180 by F, that is 0.037. Okay, what is the unit? megawatt second per degree electrical, that is M. And accelerating power is 20 MVA because the input suddenly increases by 20 MVA. The output has not changed. So this entire increase in the input will be reflected as accelerating power. So PA is 20 MVA. So acceleration is 20 PA by M, that is 540 degree per second square. Okay. Next. The kinetic energy stored in a rotor of 50 MVA, 6 pole, 60 hertz synchronous machine is 200 megajoules. Calculate the inertia constant and angular moment. That means you calculate H and M. And now you see here M is in megajoule second per radians. Okay. So there we saw electrical degrees. Now it is in radians. So what is H? H is megajoules per MVA. How many megajoules per MVA? So I have megajoules is 200 and it is 50 MVA. So 200 by 50 is equal to 4. So 4 megajoules per MVA, that is H. Next, M is GH by, in the previous case, we used 180 when you want in degrees. Now it is pi, pi by F. So G is the MVA rating, which is 50. H we have calculated is 4 pi by 60. So that is 1.06. So the correct answer is H is 4 and M is 1.06 megajoules per radian. Okay. A turbo generator, 6 poles, 50 hertz, capacity is 100 megawatts, working at 0.8 PF and has an inertia constant of 9 megajoules per MVA. Find the rotor acceleration if the mechanical input is suddenly raised to 70 megawatts when the output is 60 megawatts. So first you see here, I have the generator. The output is 60 megawatts. The load on the generator is nothing but the output of the generator. That is 60 megawatts. The input is 70 megawatts. So the accelerating power is 10 megawatts. PA is 10 megawatts. Now I have to calculate M. M, you know, is GH by 180F, right? So I need to calculate G. It is 100 megawatt at 0.8 PF. Therefore, G is equal to 100 by 0.8. That is 125 MVA. G is 125 MVA. And M is GH divided by 180F. That is 0.125. Okay. And PA is 10. And the acceleration will be PA by M. That is 80 electrical degree per second square. Clear? So I have given you a lot of MCQs. And this covers a lot of concepts, basic fundamental concepts in stability. And I hope you can, this session was useful and it will be helpful for you for all your competitive exams also. Thank you.